everybody who is present in person with us, as well as those who are online at this time or later on for a replay of the service. And we want to invite all to join together for some coffee and conversation following the service in the narthex as well. There are several announcements today. I'll read most of them, but I want to wish all fathers and grandfathers and stepfathers and other fathers happy Father's Day today as well. We've got lots of celebrations actually today, and just before we move into those, I'm going to say we want to keep Pastor Sarah, who has had another surgery, but hopefully that will be her final one before her healing is complete. We continue to pray for her as she continues in the hospital. Today is graduation Sunday, and we're going to pray our campers off to prayer off to camp this week and in July as well today. Now, before I forget it, April, you have an announcement. Yes.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm April Edwards. I've been doing the teacher for Children's Church last couple years, and just wanted a reminder that today is the last day we're going to do Children's Church right after the children's sermon. Going to make it a fun time for the kids. We're going to do a craft and play some bingo, so make sure it's a fun time for them. I would like to take a moment, though, to recognize the people that have helped throughout the year in various capacities. We have Amanda Clark, who's also has assisted in helping. Take a stand, be recognized. And then also Mr. Jim Bedell. I see he's here as well. Jim has also helped. And then Debbie Collins. I don't see her here this morning, though, but she has also helped. So it's been pretty awesome throughout this whole school year to be able to come up with some fun lessons and have some cool activities, learning about God's word and learning about faith, growing closer to God. And it's just been nice to having all the kids and get to know them and having some fun with them. So hopefully, like I said, today is the last day for the summer. There will be VBS in July that the kids can come to as well to get some more fun times and Bible verses and Bible studies and fun times. So just want to thank everybody and thank all the kids for coming, all the parents that supported, and all of my helpers that have helped throughout the year. It's been pretty fun. So just wanted to say thank you for that.
I'd like now to invite Amanda Clark to come forward as she presents the graduates and the campers.
In your bulletin, we are honoring the graduates first, but I'm still waiting for one of them to walk through the door, so we're going to switch it up and do the campers first. So if you are working at Living Water Ministries this summer or a camper there this summer, come on up and just face the people. We have Logan, who's a camp counselor, Selena, who's going to be a camper this week. The blue half sheet of paper in your bulletin also lists some of the other campers. We have Jimmy Darnell, Johnny Darnell, Johanna Holman, Carson Lassiter, Emelina Lures, Xander Lures, Isabella Lures, or Bella, Abigail Robertson, and then we also have Sarah and Gail with us this morning. They both work at the camp, and they were here last Sunday too, so you might recognize them. But we have a prayer for you. So congregation, if you would join me in prayer for these people who will be at camp this week. God, help these youth and adults experience the presence of the Holy Spirit this week at Living Water Ministries. May they experience you in a way that others look at them and see the Holy Spirit working in their life. Lord, may they be continually filled with the power of the Holy Spirit so that their life will reveal the love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control that comes from you. We pray, Lord, that your work in their hearts while they are at camp so that they become bold to share Jesus with everyone around them. May they be a witness for you everywhere they go. And may they come away from camp with a desire to live in your presence more than anything. May they never doubt who you are and what you can do. May they desire a closeness with you that sustains them. May this week at camp help them center their life around listening to your voice and praising you, the living God, with their whole being, body and soul, for the rest of their lives.
Amen. So shall it be. Thank you, camp staff and campers. You can have a seat. At this time, I'd like to invite our high school graduates forward, or any college graduates that are here, or even if your name isn't listed, but you graduated from something, we would like to honor you with this milestone in your life. So we have up here Allison and Logan. Some of our other graduates are listed on the half sheet piece of paper. We've got Hayden Carlson, Connor Edwards, Ellie Kirker, all graduating from high school, and then Sydney McCabe, who is graduating from college. So Allison and Logan, your church on this milestone day has a gift for you. The quilters have made you each a quilt, so I'm going to hand those to you now, and then we're going to clap for you, and then you can go and sit back down in your seats.
Always wonderful to celebrate events in the lives of our young people. Let's just have a moment of silence if there are no other announcements. Anyone have other announcements to make this morning that are not, or to highlight others in the bulletin? Then let's have a moment of silence and the ringing of the bell. As you're able, please stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
I was glad when they said to me,
"Let us go into the house of the Lord."
Our help is in the name of the Lord,
who made heaven and earth.
Let us join together now in the red ELW as we sing together, "You Are Mine," number 581.
Thank you.
Continuing in your bulletin on page one in the middle. Small as a mustard seed and lofty as a cedar,
the kingdom of God is growing.
While we sleep and rise night and day,
the kingdom of God is growing.
The low are brought high, the high are brought low. Let us pray. Almighty God, sower of seed, be at work among us, we pray, that your church may thrive in faithfulness, whether we are the size of a tall cedar or are a small sprig, it does not matter. You are able to put us to good use, not by our efforts, but by your power and grace we bear fruit. Produce boughs of spacious welcome. Urge us on, then, in the love of Christ. In his name we pray. Amen. Won't you please be seated for the readings from Scripture.
Good morning. The first reading is from Ezekiel chapter 17. Thus says the Lord God, I myself will take a sprig from the lofty top of the cedar. I will set it out. I will break off a tender one from the topmost of the young twigs. I myself will plant it on a high and lofty mountain. On the mountain height of Israel, I will plant it in order that it may produce boughs and bear fruit. And because a noble cedar, under it every kind of bird will live. In the shade of its branches will nest wings, creatures of every kind. All the trees of the field shall know that I am the Lord. I bring low and high tree. I make high the low tree. I dry up the green tree and make the dry tree flourish. The Lord has spoken. I will accomplish it. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The second reading is from 2 Corinthians chapter 5. So are we always confident, even though we know that while we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord? For we walk by faith, not by sight. Yes, we do have confidence, and we would rather be away from the body and at home with the Lord. So whether we are at home or away, we make it our aim to please him. For all of us must appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each may receive recompense that what has been done in the body, whether good or evil. For the love of Christ urges us on, because we are convinced that one has died for all. Therefore, all have died. He has died for all, so that those who live might live no longer than themselves, but for him who died and was raised from them. From now on, therefore, we regard no one from the human point of view. Even though we once knew Christ from the human point of view, we know him no longer in that way. So if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please rise for the gospel.
Holy Gospel according to Mark, the fourth chapter. Jesus said, "The kingdom of God is as if someone would scatter seed on the ground and would sleep and rise night and day, and the seed would sprout and grow. He does not know how. The earth produces of itself first the stalk, then the head, then the full grain in the head. But when the grain is ripe, at once he goes in with his sickle, because the harvest has come." He also said, "With what can we compare the kingdom of God? Or what parable will we use for it? It is like a mustard seed, which, when sown upon the ground, is the smallest of all the seeds on earth. Yet when it is sown, it grows up and becomes the greatest of all shrubs, and puts forth large branches, so that the birds of the air can make nests in its shade." With many such parables, he spoke the word to them as they were able to hear it. He did not speak to them except in parables, but he explained everything in private to his disciples. The Gospel of the Lord. Won't you please be seated, and I'd like to invite any young people who would like to come forward for a conversation with me to do so at this time. Let's see, shall we have a seat here? Oh, lots of kids today. Maybe we don't have enough room between these two. You squish on in. Oh yeah, there we go. Wow, where did all you come from? Ellie was all by herself the last time. There she comes. Hi, Ellie. You can sit here. You want to squish in? There we go. Well, great. Oh, and I forgot my little prop. But you know what? Today we're going to talk about some very teeny things that become some very big things. And you know, we just read in the gospel about Jesus' parable where he said the mustard seed is the smallest of seeds, but it grows into a huge shrub. And you know, he's using this illustration to talk about our faith. because our faith can do that too. Now I'm going to get up for a second and get a couple of little props. And for everybody at home, we have to put this right out front. And for everybody here, you can see what I'm doing here. No, it's not wine. It's a wine bottle, but it got just water in it. And look at this. I picked these off of that particular plant. This is called a columbine. Look at those seed pods on that plant there. I'm going to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. And I have to cut some off of the other. How many do we have? 1, 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 11. Well, now the Lord is in this sermon today for the kids. Here we go. You hang on to that for a second because I'm going to show you something. Yeah, you know what's going to happen, huh? There we go. It's a little sticky. It feels like it's a little sticky, doesn't it? Ah, yeah, Ellie. Ah, good. Now, these are seed pods, and you can see that they look just like what's on that plant. Whoa, what happened? Did I drop some someplace? Thank you, because I am missing two, and we can't have that. Did I give you one? Okay, good. There we go. You get the whole stem. How's that? You can hold it that way. Well, I'm giving these seeds because if you open up the seed pod, and I guess I have to get one for myself to show you. If you open up the seed pod, you'll see some very small seeds inside. And you know, it's a little sticky, but you know, before you do that, what I wanted to tell you is that, see, there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 5 and a half blossoms on here right now. And this particular plant has already gone from a seed to a big, oh, it's almost like a bush. That's a huge columbine this year because it's a good year for growing. But when you get home, leave this on your dresser or on a table or something and let it dry out, because these seed pods should become black. And when they get black, you know what happens? Even when you don't touch them, those seed pods go whoosh, and they throw their seeds out. I don't think they actually throw them, but they scatter all around, and then what's going to happen? What? That's right, and you're both right. You said they're going to die, and Jesus told us, remember, that unless a seed dies and goes into the earth, it doesn't rise again. And that is exactly what you probably learned. Well, I'm going to open this up just to show you the white or green seeds that are inside, because they're so tiny you can hardly even see them. Oops, I'm sorry. Let's see. Can you? Oh, no, this one isn't a good one. Let's see. Did you open yours already? Did you? And what did you find? They're seeds, yeah. These look like beans, but these are not the seeds. The seeds are inside there. And you know what I think God is telling me? Don't open these until they're dry. Because when they're dry, then they're going to... Yeah, they're going to become new plants, little baby plants again. But this is the lesson for all of us today, that Jesus said, if you have faith, even as small as a columbine seed, now he said seed, now he said mustard seed, but they're going to be as small as these seeds that you have in your hand, you will see what your faith will do. And every time we have some kind of a challenge, and I know I have some in my life, and I bet you do too, whenever there's something that's hard to do, if we ask Jesus to come into our life and help us, that is the... It's just like these little hard seeds that don't seem to be going to be doing anything are going to become just like that, a big plant, and we will find that we've got help that we never thought we would have before. So keep these seeds at home and let them dry out a little bit. Now, you know, they might not be old enough. Sometimes seeds have to be a little older in order to really sprout, but you try it anyway. Let them dry out until they get real sort of hard and not hard, but probably black or real dark brown, and then you can pop them open very easily, because as soon as you do that, you better do it outside in some dirt, because you know those things are going to go right out of your hand. Mm-hmm. You have some in your field? They're pretty, aren't they? Do you have some that are a different color than these? Because they're different colors, too. Are they purple, too? Yours purple? Don't know. Take a look this afternoon when you go out there, okay, and see. Because these are just about finished blooming now, but yours in your field might still be blooming nicely. And then you can collect some seeds from yours and make more flowers. So that's the lesson for us about faith. It's only going to keep growing and growing and growing as long as we trust in Jesus. Shall we have a prayer before you go to your last Sunday school before a summer break? Okay? Let's pray. Loving and gracious God, it's so wonderful to watch how your creation works, how from such little things, such great things can come. We ask that all of our young people and all of us adults too would look for the signs of your new growth in our own lives, that in these days to come, by our faith, we might know that you are bringing us better things that we can even ask for or imagine. And all of this we pray, confidence in your presence in our lives, in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Well, you enjoy this last Sunday school before September 8th, I think it is, when you come back, okay? And have a great summer. And before we trip over this, I'll put it back. Well, today's readings from Scripture all have an element of a suspense and rather unpredictability about them, much like a good mystery story that unfolds in ways that you'd never expect. Although we do all try to guess how things are probably going to turn out. But in our first reading today, the Hebrew priest Ezekiel has become God's prophetic spokesperson during the time of Israel's exile in Babylon. You remember when Ezekiel was commanded to eat a scroll that had on it words of woe and lamentation? A sad bunch of words. Well, he then embodied those words. And words of destruction after the king of Judah attempted unsuccessfully to enlist the power of Egypt to come and save them and combat the Babylonian forces that were taking the people off into exile. But it didn't succeed. He was trying to do something by his own power. But exile was intended by God in order for Israel to wake up, to be shaken up and renewed into a more faithful and obedient Judaic society. Among all the prophets, Ezekiel has been called by theologian W.F. Albright as one of the greatest spiritual figures of all time, in spite of his tendency to abnormality. Well, he went on to say that the genius of Hebrew prophets is, in fact, that they were not normal. They had insight into God's ways of seeing and guiding that most of the rest of us don't have. And what we find in today's first reading is that, in fact, Ezekiel envisioned a new Israel to demonstrate God's power to restore and renew the Israelites to be God's own. Well, there are things that happen in our own lives that seem to have unlikely outcomes. Think of yourself for a moment as a teenager. What does or did the world feel like you at that time? What might you have been thinking you'd become? Some of those dreams were fulfilled. Some brought disappointment. But the unfolding chapters of our lives always seem to have a cumulative purpose. When we look back on what's happened to us, even over just a few years, we have insight into what God is revealing to us and unfolding within each of us as one year leads to the next. And we'll want to pay attention to what God is doing with us. Remember how Samuel, as a young boy in the temple, first learned to recognize the sound of God's voice calling his name in the night? Samuel, Samuel, Samuel. Well, he learned that he was called to prophesy some hard words to his teacher, Eli. And eventually, he was called to bring about the replacement of King Saul by the shepherd boy David. Each step of the way, Samuel is taught and strengthened by his life experiences. And each step of the way in our lives, we seem to be strengthened to do more than we thought ever possible. Ezekiel gives the Hebrews good news today after the rather depressing announcement that preceded today's reading in the Bible. In spite of challenges, he writes, there will come new tender shoots from the cedars of Lebanon. There will be new growth and care for all of God's creation under the fresh growing branches of the new Israel as the old dies away and the new takes root. Ezekiel isn't so abnormal after all, is he? In fact, he's a Reformation project prophet. One of ours. The gospel today, you see, describes another agricultural progression that unfolds every year right here in the fields of our own county. Farmers wait for the snows to melt and warmer weather to arrive. When they can get their equipment into the fields, prepare the soil, and plant row after row of seeds. And then, as in Jesus' day, the farmer would sleep and rise night and day, and the seed would sprout and grow. He does not know how. The miracle of natural growth begins. When the sun and rain cooperate, of course, and the plants grow and mature by harvest time. Well, some of these seeds we plant ourselves are so small, as the kids have just learned, that it's hard to imagine anything could come from them. But each is a microcosm of a fully grown plant. And under the best of circumstances, as with the smallest of mustard seeds in Jesus' parable today, such a tiny speck grows into a huge shrub and provides for us and others of God's creatures with food and shade and shelter. As we give thanks today for high school and college graduates of our congregation, we're also asking for God's blessing on each of them as they set out to experience new adventures. We look forward to hearing how God will allow their lives to grow in new and even unexpected ways in the days ahead. And on this Father's Day, our fathers who enabled our conception and who continue to witness the growth and maturity of their children can attest that being a father doesn't mean you know exactly what's going to unfold with your children, does it? As they move into the chapters of their own adult life. Fatherhood requires a fair dose of faith, guidance, and trust that whatever path children follow into the future, it will be one where, if they choose, the Spirit of God will accompany them and direct them in ways to a fulfilling life that continues to be guided by the Spirit of Christ. I recently offered a prayer at a family wedding reception and noted that the love between two people may feel like it was love at first sight. But in fact, our God has a hand in these newfound relationships that end up at the altar. And quite often the couple acknowledges the truth that when they look back on their early times together, as in fact my niece and her husband knew did, her new husband did, that's exactly what's happened. Well, the Apostle Paul puts the message in another way for today. He says, we are always confident, for we walk by faith, not by sight. We can look at the world around us with eyes that have informed us of how things work. But we can also look with the eyes of faith, not only at our environment, but also at one another in a different way. The Apostle Paul writes, from now on, we regard no one from a human point of view. For if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. Fathers, graduates, campers, each of us is a wonderful mystery unfolding through our experiences day by day. And each of us is becoming new every day. You are becoming new in Christ. Even though many of the first century Israelites regarded Jesus from a human point of view and, in fact, argued with him and pushed back a bit, we know him no longer that way. There is a future, some known and some unknown, ahead of us for each one of us as we continue our walk with Jesus in this church season of the spirit of spiritual growth. So, graduates and campers, all of us, welcome the unpredictable. Watch for the unanticipated or the unexpected. Wonder with awe at something unexplainable that you experience or see. And in all things, as you sleep and rise night and day, know that God is at work within each of you, writing chapter after chapter in your life's experience of the Spirit's presence beyond what you can even ask for or imagine. Amen. And shall we now join together and sing our hymn of the day, For the Fruit of All Creation, in the red ELW, number 679.
Oh, us confess together our faith with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord.
He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary.
He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. We come before the triune God to pray for our communities, ourselves, and the world. Lord, you are here with these graduates. They are moving on to new life adventures. Watch over their comings and their goings as they reflect on days past and set their hearts and minds on their adventures in the times to come. Use this congregation to support them in their journey. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Tend to all who journey by faith and who wait with patience for the fulfillment of your healing promises. We especially lift up those who this congregation has brought to you by name. We pray for John, Bob, Lillian, Mary, and Pat, Mary, Roger, Mary Jo, Jan, Pastor Sarah, Angie, Aaron, Mark Bars and family, Carly, Kathy, Andy. We pray for the family of Pastor Chris Anderson, who passed away this week. We pray for those that have gone to on their mission to Kenya. We also pray for our friends in the armed services, Jake and Nick. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Lord, you are the one who knows how special fathers are. You made them that way. How else can a man work so hard, give so much, and love unconditionally without your strength? Let us also praise those men who have fathered us in their role as mentors, guides, coaches, scoutmasters, and teachers. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Lord, please take care of our dads. Though they are brave and protective, they must also be frightened sometimes. When money runs low, when we need things, when we're hurt or sick, when their hearts break because they can't do it all, please help us to let them know how much we love them and how much you love them. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Lord, bless those men who are about to become fathers. May they openly delight in their children. Lord, for that dad who has lost a child, please let him know that you are there, right beside him. For nothing else can heal a heart so torn. For the father who is parenting alone, strengthen him with your love. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
And for those of us whose father is already with you, give him a hug, Lord, and tell him it's from his children. Saving God, hear our prayer.
Receive our prayers, O God, and come quickly to our aid through the power of the Spirit and the love of Jesus Christ. Now let us greet one another in the name of our risen Lord. May the peace of Christ be always with you.
Peace.
God has provided us with all that we need. Let us now return a portion of what God has so freely given to us by bringing our tithes and offerings.
Gifts that we bring this day, that they may be a sign of our commitment to your kingdom and a pledge of our love for you and your world.
Multiply the work done by our time, treasures, and talents, that your presence and compassion may be known in all the earth. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection open to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join in their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, Lord of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me."
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Christ has set the table with more than enough for all. Come.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen.
Let us pray. Jesus, bread of life, we have received from your table more than we could ever ask.
As you have nourished us in this meal, now strengthen us to love the world with your own life. In your name we pray. Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
Our closing hymn is Faith of Our Fathers in the Red ELW, number 812.